Who's tired of hearing about Emerald Ash Borer? Julie. you know, I always feel like I'm beating a dead horse with this, but I feel the same way when I do talks about tree planting. I always feel like, gosh, do we know how to plant trees right yet? You know, but every time I do a talk on tree planting, we get into discussion about it, and there's a lot of nuance to it, and the same is true here. So while it may seem like a tired topic, we don't have a confirmation in the state yet, that's a good thing in my mind. That's buying us time to get ready before we have this problem in our laps. And so while it may seem like we're crying wolf, and we have to be real careful about that, or we won't be taken seriously once there is a wolf, it's a good thing to continue to talk about and make sure that we all have a fresh sense of what's actually going on. And they talk about how it usually takes, you know, a little repetition for this stuff to stay in our brains, right? So with all that in mind, we'll talk about EAB for a little while. This is the classic photo that's all over the internet. Julie, is this Ohio? Is that right? Do you remember? I don't know. It doesn't matter, but...
Sure.
Yeah. Very definitive answer. I like that. Anyways, it's in an obviously an EAB infested state where we'll see the before and after here in a minute. Emerald ash borer, Agrillis planipennis, is that how we pronounce it, Julie? It's an Asian beetle. It only really attacks ash and things in the olive family of plants. It's not a significant pest in Asia because their trees have co-evolved alongside the pest and developed defenses against it. And there are also some natural predators of EAB in Asia as well. It's particularly devastating here because our trees have not been exposed to EAB before. Our native ash are prime targets for this beetle. Most cases with wood-boring insects, they need a tree that's kind of declining to some degree or at least stressed before they can really actively take hold and infest a tree. And that's not the case with EAB. Emerald ash borer is going to come in and infest perfectly healthy and vigorous trees. Again, that's all by virtue of this separation that they've had over the millennia that's now brought them together in disastrous results. The adults do foliage feed on trees, which is, you know, more of a minor stress. It's the larval immature stage that feeds on the vascular tissue of the tree. This makes it particularly devastating to the tree in the sense that it's only feeding on live tissue and not burrowing into the heartwood itself. The silver lining that I like to put on all that is that it makes these dead ash trees particularly viable for wood utilization projects without having all those galleries deep into the heartwood. So again, just revisiting that picture we just saw, before and after. This could have easily been a block from the 1940s or 50s with American elm lining it. That beautiful cathedral-shaped branching habit of elm was just ideal for street trees, and ash worked filled that niche really well. And so, rather than beating the drum of diversity, the public went out and planted ash en masse after Dutch elm disease. There's a handful of others. What's the other tree we just planted the crap out of after we lost our elms along the streets? Pin oak, sure, yeah. Silver maple. Yeah, it's no surprise that we yearn to get this canopy reestablished on the streets, and we'll turn to whatever tree will do that. But we're really not getting the message with planting an entire block with one species like this. I just for conversation's sake, I have heard the argument made that. You can simplify the management strategy for the city and still achieve community-wide diversity with an approach like this. So if you say the 300 block of Brown Street is going to have this tree on the streets, and we'll allow homeowners to plant something different if they really want to, but this is what the city is going to do on this particular block. And we're not going to repeat that tree for X number of miles or blocks as the rules dictate. And so I'm kind of on the fence about how good or bad of an idea that is. You still leave an entire city block prone to having loss like this, but you can still achieve diversity community-wide and simplify the strategy for the city. Why would it be good for the city to have a whole block that's all ash? Come on, guys.
Take them all out.
Huh?
Easy to take them all out.
Take them all out, or to prune them the same way. Different species need different pruning cycles. They grow at different rates. They have different branching structures. And if you have a whole block that you can prune on the same cycle, that really makes things easy. Instead of having to piecemeal go through and apply that pruning cycle to your ash in more of a polka-dotted fashion all over town. Now, obviously, you're still going to have some of that to do, but if the city is moving forward with this as more of the strategy with some diversity amongst that as the homeowners decide to do something different, then it's much easier for the city to lay out where that pruning strategy is going to take place and when. So, I don't know. I've just heard that put forth. Does anybody have any comments or thoughts on that approach? Would it be nice to have whole city blocks with a single species from a pruning standpoint? Yeah, kinda. But is it not a big deal to have them all over the place and not all on one block?
By the time you get to them anyway, they're all out of control anyway.
I won't ask what the pruning cycle is. Down in Austin, Texas, they have an effective pruning cycle of about 93 years. I'll tell you why. When you crunch the numbers, you have to include all the trees that were planted and didn't live long enough to ever get pruned. And so that really jacks up the pruning cycle numbers to where there's so many trees that never even get pruned that it gives you this number that seems like they never come around to prune, when in actuality they are coming around and pruning regularly, but there's so much attrition, there's so much mortality that it makes that when you actually crunch the number with the equation, it seems really high. So Emerald Ash Borer really goes after all Fraxinus. They seem to have sort of a preference and an order that they like to attack different species in. But they're going to get around to all these. So the green and white ash that, of course, are what we have the most of, seem to be what they really like and really hit first. Some of the real popular, this Marshall Seedless, Patmore, Autumn Purple. Lots of times you'll have people saying that they have a purple ash. They're talking about white ash. It's just this cultivar name with the, referring to the fall color that they're talking about. You know, it's a great tree, and it's going to be sad to lose it. It's tough as nails. They often do provide a lot of benefits to wildlife, environmental benefits, the street tree canopy that we saw just a bit ago. But as the buffet dries up on green and white, they will get around to the black and that might be along the rivers with the green and the blue, the ash that might have been planted by a homeowner here and there. But a very small number of those. Our state champion blue ash is down in Nebraska City somewhere, and I don't think it goes outside of that southeast corner of the state a whole lot. Does anybody speak to blue ash much? George, you have any?
I haven't seen very many at all, just small trees.
But you have a couple here and there?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Question?
Yes.
Two questions. So when the EAB goes through, like if you had an isolated blue ash or something, did it be missed and survive? Or did it undefined?
No. I don't think so. Now what we're finding in the infested states where EAB has kind of sort of run its course, so to speak, there's always outliers that aren't killed. It's not going to kill 100% of ash trees, but it's going to be up in the 90s. Do you have a number you use usually, Julie? Kind of problematic to put a number on it, isn't it? But the vast majority of those Fraxinus are all going to be impacted. They're all going to be tested, I'll tell you that much. 100% of the trees will be visited and tested by the beetle. There sometimes it's a, I don't know what the explanation is, if it's a genetic twist of fate, something. You want to speak to that at all, Julie? Why we see outliers or the theory?
There's a lot of theories. I don't know anything at this point. There is some research being done generally by USDA on some of those outlier trees to see if there's a reason. My belief is that if EAB finds an ash tree, regardless of what species it is, it will be able to reproduce in there, and most likely that tree will.
Mm-hmm.
The question will be in a state like Nebraska, where we don't have a continuous forest forest cover that they do in the east is, will we have pockets of EAD, or will we have pockets of ash trees that remain as fragments because EAD isn't introduced, because they're not able to just hop from tree to tree to tree.
Right,
so
right.
So we may have, once EAD is found in the state, we may have immediate impacts in like the Lincoln and Omaha, the metro areas where we anticipate seeing EAD.
Right.
But Mullen, Nebraska may not see EAD for a very long time.
Yeah, it could be decades and decades before the whole state's impacted. And I agree with you on that. The beetle itself really only moves a couple miles in its lifespan. So that would be a pretty slow creep across the United States in and of itself. So how's it spreading rapidly?
Fire
people in general, yeah. Whether it's pallet wood, packing material, the firewood. As Julie mentioned, you could have populations of ash that are geographically isolated, and there are no people bringing the beetle close enough.
So you could have like some windbreak trees out on an isolated farm that might survive if they're not within a couple miles of a city.
I think it's still a matter of time, but yeah, it could be a really long time before you see that mortality in every single corner of the state. And it's anybody's guess how that's going to play out. As we'll see in the maps a bit ago, it could be coming in from a couple different places in the state from a proximity standpoint.
So if the larva only live on the cambium live part of the tree, when you have firewood, it's usually aged and dead. So how are the larvae surviving in the firewood?
Julie? You just need to come up here, maybe.
So very rarely do people take down trees for firewood that are healthy.
Yeah.
Most of the time when we're taking down a tree, it's because it's dead or damaged in some way. There is no... People don't always move firewood that's cured. So even if you take down your tree in September, that larva is already active in the tree, and if you move it before the adults would start flying, then emerging and flying in the next spring, you will take that larva with you. EAD will not reinfest a down tree, a dead tree,
right.
It will continue to emerge from that tree the next spring.
Right.
And so that's how EAB can move in firewood. EAB, Asian longhorn beetle, gypsy moth,
yeah.
Japanese pine sawyer beetle, sudden death, the list of pathogens that are known to move on firewood is large.
Yeah. And all you have to do is visit a woodpile and you can pull bark off of those logs and find, little critters in there. They're not all harmful invasive pests, of course, but a lot of them are, and people have get the brilliant idea of bringing firewood with them so they don't have to go forage for it wherever they camp. Now with the life cycle of the beetle, you also have this problematic timing where the adult beetles emerge kind of around Mother's Day, sort of mid-May, and that's kind of prime camping season when things are just warming up and the mosquitoes maybe aren't bad yet, and everybody's scrambling to get some camping in before it gets really hot and buggy outside. So there's that correlation, too, that makes the timing a little problematic for moving firewood around as well. Yeah?
What about EAB in privet, lilac, and some of the other shrubs?
Right. So it's been confirmed in fringe tree, which I don't think is going to be a huge problem around here in terms of that being a big component. I don't think it's been found in privet or lilac, but they're in that same family of plants. There's at least maybe potential for those plants to get have large enough stems that it might be attractive to a gryllus, but...
So USDA and Michigan State University have been doing a lot of research on alternative hosts because of the concerns about other plants in the olive family. And they basically do force feeding studies where you enclose a plant in some way and then introduce beetles to see if they can mate, lay eggs, those eggs hatch out, and larvae be able to reproduce. That was done initially when the EAB was found and there wasn't any positive finds. Then about 2 years ago in 2014, an individual in Ohio found evidence of EAB reproducing populations on fringe tree. Looking back at the likely point in time when EAB started feeding on those fringe trees and reproducing, they believe that it correlates really well to the peak of the EAB populations So there was so much pressure on the ash trees that the AV were likely looking for alternative hosts.
They're getting desperate.
They're getting desperate. there was also some evidence that the fringe tree was able to fight back a little bit. The trees were not dead, but they were infested. So when I talk with the public about it, you know, like Omaha Master Gardeners definitely mention it to them because of the fringe trees that are in the state of Nebraska, most of them are going to be along that Missouri River. Omaha, there's one in the Arboretum in Brownville if anybody wants to go take a look. But if you get much past Lincoln, it's probably not a tree for the state of Nebraska or a large shrub for the state of Nebraska. So I think the fringe tree aspect is pretty minor for our state. If it would show up in lilac, that would be a lot more significant because we've got lilac everywhere. But at this point, there's no evidence that it's doing that.
Yeah. Anybody know offhand, where is fringe tree native to?
Eastern
New England, kind of?
There's a North American one that's native farther east, and there's a Chinese.
Okay. All right. Interesting. So this is current as of January, 25 states in 14 years. 2002, when EAB was first discovered, that's not even year zero for the beetle. That's just the year that it got on our radar. And so I think that most of the models showed that it was lurking around Michigan 6-8 years or so before it was detected, not only because it wasn't known to be a pest in North America at all, but because we just weren't really looking for it at all. It wasn't on the radar, so to speak. So as I mentioned, that 2 to 4 mile creep across the state would take a long time, and it's really people that have, in the course of just a little over a decade, have really moved it around a lot throughout the country. So we're pretty hemmed in. Here's a close-up of those confirmations. Red Oak, Iowa, 30 miles from Omaha. St. Joe, Missouri, again, 30 miles. I mean, these are all in reference to Omaha, which you can add the numbers up a little bit further for Lincoln. Kansas City, Boulder. Not really any confirmations to the north of us, but we're pretty well surrounded by confirmations of this pest. So, as I mentioned, is it going to come in first at Ponca State Park? Is it going to come in first around Henry Dorley Zoo, Indian Caves, somewhere over here in the Panhandle? Who knows? If you have that answer, tell me, and we can make a lot of money. Community Reddit. Our Forest Health Department has phenomenal handouts on all this stuff, and we'll have some of those later on, but they're all available on our website. I think the website is on a slide in a little while here. This is a great one here, just getting into this readiness planning, this topic we're talking about here today. So this speaks to why we're getting into inventories at all. We talked about inventories for EAB readiness. In specifically, how many ash do you have in the community? What's that species breakdown? Where are they at? How big are they? And how good a shape are they in? And this is all very, 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 very valuable. I mean, it's requisite information for a management plan, in my opinion. I mean, you can write a management plan or a readiness plan for EAB without having an inventory, but there's a lot of conjecture in that. So most of our messaging. While we don't have a confirmation yet, any of those trees that are in poor or even in some cases fair condition, get them out now while you have the money for it. Just do it, because you're going to have plenty of other dead trees to take out once the mortality starts to snowball, and you'll have other things to do rather than taking care of trees that you could have justified taking out now. Now, that doesn't mean take out every single ash in the community. As I mentioned, these are the trees that are in poor condition that you can make a case for taking out anyways. Otherwise, you have a public relations nightmare on your hands if you start taking out perfectly healthy ash trees. There will be people that squawk, and they will get press, and you will not look like the hero in the end. Replant with diversity. Gosh, I've hit on this a number of times, but we cannot just, you know, I get this question all the time. What should we be planting behind ash? And I get this impression from a number of people that ask this, that they're looking for one tree or a couple trees. And I tell them, we need to be planting everything in the kitchen sink behind EAB, not just 1, 2, 3, or half a dozen species. We need to be throwing lots of different things back into the community forest in those vacant spaces. And in some cases, yeah, yeah.
I'm just wondering then, so after Dutch Elm came through and wiped everything out, why wasn't there a diversity planet at that time? Because it's basically repeating history.
We are repeating history, yeah, yeah. And that's why we keep beating the drum of diversity, because it doesn't seem to be getting through to the general public. And we need all you guys beating that drum as well for everybody that you talk to about this. I almost feel like that's the most important message to most homeowners. Most homeowners probably don't have an ash. It's maybe, I don't know, in most of the inventories we've done, it's anywhere from, on the low end, maybe 8% of the community forest in a community, all the way up to maybe 20. So even at 20%, you're talking maybe one out of five people having a tree on their property at best. So most people still probably aren't going to be directly impacted. They don't have an ash tree themselves. And so that's where the diversity message is a really more important one, to be widespread rather than all the nitty gritty about the bug itself and what it's doing. Would you agree? So that gets to the public awareness, the diversity message. But yeah, with Dutch Elm, we did plant a whole lot of a couple things. And so we still have work to do on getting that message across. And it's got to come from the nursery industry too. You know, it's you got to work it from both sides. When we're preaching diversity outside of the context of EAB, and we're just saying, here's a great new tree. You know, we got tree lists up here. Japanese Emperor Oak might be well adapted to parts of Nebraska. And then people go, okay, where do I go buy that? I want to try it. They go, I don't know. I'll have to get back to you on that, you know? So it has to be coming from both sides. You know, the nursery industry isn't going to offer the diversity of material if the public isn't demanding it. And the public isn't going to demand it unless they are aware that those trees exist. So we kind of have to be working both sides of this thing in order for the industry to be making the diverse mix of plant material available for people to try. And I'm not saying that industries don't have a decent amount of diversity available, but there's always more work to be done. Yeah, Luke. I think it's not a regulated item here yet, but once we have a confirmation here, it will not be a plant material that can be moved through the state. To what degree?
The reason I bring that up is, so you think about, real estate developers and how they're building new homes.
Buying large lots of trees.
Yeah, they're buying large lots of trees.
Yeah. Right.
And that was just something that was interesting to me is,
yep.
The guy I worked with was telling me that he saw that a developer was planting ash trees for the houses.
Yeah, yeah. And
recently, a couple years ago.
Yeah, and he went to the nursery. He said, I need 400 trees for my development. What do you got that's cheap? And he said, whoa, do I have a deal for you? Right? You know? Because he needs to get those things out of his inventory too. So, I don't have a hard and fast answer for you on that. Once we have a confirmation, then it'll become a regulated item. But at that point, existing inventory can still be sold.
All right, so all of this is regulated under the Nebraska Plant Protection and Plant Pest Act. And that regulates the movement of nursery stock because of the concern of plant pest issues on it. Now, for something like Emerald Ash Borer, we can't just proactively prohibit the movement of ash trees because currently the ash trees don't have a plant pest.
Right.
That any more than we can say you can't plant Scotch pines because you might get pine wilt, or you can't plant oak trees because they could get sudden oak death or golden oak spotted borer. That's not how our law is written. Now, once EAB is found, you will not be able to move ash nursery stock from within the quarantine area to outside the quarantine area.
Oh, only that way.
Right. You could still move it in if it's inspected and certified. At that point, we would have to determine if there is a way to legitimately certify ash, which generally there's not, so we may make a special provision that ash can be sold. That has happened in some states, that has not happened in all states that are being generally what happens is that the market makes that correct step, and the willingness of the public to buy ash bottoms out.
Right.
Then growers go through and hold those. They know that they're not going to market, they need to use that land to do something else that's saleable.
Mm-hmm.
Is the quarantine area set by county lines, or how is that set? Most likely it will be by county lines.
So, Luke, that's a great outreach opportunity. We might be able to work together on taking the carrot approach instead of the stick, and just getting the right information in the hands of these developers to make better choices. Say, well, I don't want the absolute cheapest tree because you're going to, you know, offload this problematic species to me. So that may be, you know, an outreach opportunity we could talk about in terms of approaching these developers on making smart choices on how they populate the streets and their developments. So let's talk about that.
I'm trying to do that in sewer with development areas with the contractor or just in the fee to, you know, comprehensive plan, kind of redoing that to where we have a list of tree species that we want to plant the tree right away.
Uh-huh. Okay, right. Yeah, so that species list in the ordinance can be at least a way of having language that you can refer to when there's a problem. You could say, well, you guys didn't approach us about all these trees you're planting, and we got a list here that, you know, it's, again, it's up to you whether you prohibit species or just discourage them. You can set that language however you choose, but at least you do it on the front end so you have something to point to, saying, you guys got to do your diligence before filling the streets with these trees. You know, check with us on what we're really looking to see in the community or not see. So, good point. Yes, Heather.
Is EAB selective on an age of tree, or will it go after
a? I think it needs a sufficient size branch to go after. No.
I see.
Dang it. All right. Okay. And maybe that's a good point to get into the survey. We brought some government employees together, whether it's city government, state government. We got together to bring up a forester from Kansas City to talk about how he surveys for the beetle in Kansas City. Trained people here on his methods, and then split up into groups and go around Omaha and look for the beetle in a couple areas. And we were not successful finding the beetle. What we did find, though, when we went to the zoo, which was kind of ground zero in our minds for Omaha as a likely location, you have a lot of out-of-state RV traffic to the zoo, the ball field, downtown Omaha, that sort of thing. So that was a great place to start looking. But what we were honing in on is we're really trying to find young white ash that still had nice smooth bark that we could look for symptoms in trees that weren't dead already. Because if you wait, if your first EAB find is in a dead tree that a tree service is taking down, then you're at least 3-4 years behind the eight ball, and that population has been building for a while. So trying to be a little bit more proactive with it, we were focusing more on live trees that were most likely to be able to identify those symptoms in. And green ash has a corkier bark at a younger age. It's hard to look at exit holes and that sort of thing. And so what we found downtown was between the hail damage they all got smacked with a couple years ago and the native borers that they were all lousy with, and just all the other urban stress that these trees were under, it was a needle in a haystack trying to look for these pie-in-the-sky symptoms of EAB in a tree that's still alive. And so while it's possible that we could have walked by trees that had EAB in them, there's just no practical way of looking for those particular symptoms in those trees with all the other things going on with them. So, yeah.
Sorry to ask so many questions.
Oh, I love it. You keep it up.
Is there a way, I know you said that when it was Michigan where it first showed up, probably there for 6 or 7 years before they discovered it.
Mm-hmm.
So is there a way to detect it early on? Or do you just have to look for the little D-shaped exit holes of the larva?
Well, even exit holes, you're kind of late to the game. Because if you're finding exit holes from the ground, then the tree's pretty heavily infested, probably. They do tend to like to infest the top of the tree first. And so by the time those D-shaped holes are down to where you can see them visibly and distinguish it from a round hole or a larger hole or what have you, you probably got a tree with lots of other symptoms at play. Am I right, Julie? All right, I'm going to keep checking back with you. I need you to keep me honest with all this stuff.
Can you detect it without the D holes?
Yeah, so again, what we were when native borers go in an ash tree, It forms kind of like a knuckle around that entrance or exit hole. The tree responds with this response wood around that. That's pretty characteristic. If there's larvae in a young tree, and it's at a young stage of infestation, you'll have more of these splits without this enlarged area around it. And sometimes that can be misconstrued for sun scald or frost cracked. It looks very similar to that sort of thing. And there was one tree that we got all excited about where we saw that kind of thing. And you know, you carve the bark back and you don't find the galleries that you're looking for. You're just seeing abiotic symptoms instead. So you can find it in trees that aren't dead already. It's just really tough. Anything to add on that in other states or?
We look for the symptomology. So we look for dieback, flagging branches, wilting. The problem is that that's how most trees respond to most pest problems and what all trees look like in Nebraska by August. So it's a little difficult. Other things we can look for are evidence of woodpecker damage, because that larvae is a really great food source for them. So we can look for what we call blonding or flecking, particularly up in the tops of the trees. The beetles do like to start at the top and work their way down. So that's what Graham was referring to. Now, I'm 5'4". I can see the ground. That makes it a little difficult. We do set and monitor EAB traps across the state along with the USDA. Those are pheromone-baited traps. They're okay. They're a great outreach tool. They're okay as a survey tool, but it probably works best when you've got a fairly high population. But it's better than nothing out there, and it's a great outreach tool. So NDA targets really target spots that are high likelihood for introduction and establishment, i.e. Mahoney State Park, Platte River State Park, Indian Cave, Ponca. Places where we think there's high likelihood of it coming in. The biggest thing is just getting more and more people out there looking for it. You know, when it was found in Michigan for the first time, it wasn't regulatory. It wasn't anybody that's, you know, supposed to find it. It was a homeowner finding it. So that's why the more trainings that we do like this, telling people to look for odd things, the more likely we are to have somebody actually call in with it. And that's what we really want to encourage.
Yeah, very well said. And the criteria. Oh, go ahead.
So the bug will live on the firewood. Does it make it through the chipping process?
Not for the most part. So with the regulation, the quarantine requirements and that sort of thing, we'll get to in just a minute here. But you're going to look to have those chips done at least 1 inch or less in two dimensions, and that's going to eliminate most of the larvae that'll be in the tree. It just makes me sick to see trees getting buried or burned and not get any value out of them at all. So you can debark down to a half inch into the heartwood and keep whole logs intact. Like I said earlier, the saving grace of this whole thing is that it stays in the vascular tissue. And so the interior of that log is more or less intact, at least for, rot excluded or anything like that.
So that was my other question. So you would debark the firewood actually to save the
day? Yeah, and there's some fumigation and some heat treatment methods that we'll see in a slide in just a little bit here as well. This is probably as good a time as any to point out that we have a grant called Full Circle Benefits, where we're going to be investigating capturing the most value out of not only live trees, but dead trees as well. And the live portion is kind of our bread and butter already, but the wood utilization part of it is something we're really going to try to bring as many people to the table as possible to figure out, you know, how can we really have a grassroots network in place that's ready to take advantage of this tidal wave of ash wood that's going to come once we have this problem in the state. Because we need to be prepared to make the most out of that wood and do something productive with it. Now, down in Kansas City, they have a urban lumber company. It's a nonprofit organization that originally was just accepting raw chips and logs from tree services and turning that into a mulch product that they resold. And what they found was it was a perfect relationship with these people to start milling dimensional and live edge lumber. And so what they found was that if they waived the tipping fee for the tree service to come dump chips, then they would provide logs to urban lumber to process into products that they sell just alongside the mulch. Just recently, Whole Foods decided to break ground on a new location in Kansas City, and they ordered 16,000 board feet of wood. And they want ash from EAB affected trees specifically, and so that's that's a good indicator that there are markets for this stuff outside of highly specialized furniture and that sort of thing. We can use it on a larger scale, even though wood utilization is still kind of the tip of that pyramid of what it's going to be used for. The vast majority of it's going to be chipped for trails or, you know, what have you. But there are plenty of good candidates for really nice projects. If I get a chance, I'll pull up photos of Traverwood Library. It's in Michigan, and they embraced EAB wood in a big way as well. Not only with flooring, countertops, paneling for the walls, but even the large picture windows that they had, easily as big as this garage door, they took branches from EAB infested trees, debarked them, left the galleries intact, and just lacquered them, and used them as decorative accents that look like load-bearing structures that break up those picture windows. Really neat work, and it can be done. It takes a lot of coordination. It takes a lot of people that along that chain of utilization, from dead ash tree to flooring, from dead ash tree to furniture, what have you. There's a number of players that need to be all in place for that to happen, and any missing link in the chain, and it's not going to. So with Full Circle Benefits, we'll be looking to expand that conversation, have some dialogues about that, and connect as many producers and artisans as possible. So back to more of this inventory stuff. More of the same that we saw just a minute ago. With the inventory, we can see how big of a component is ash in the community. I don't have a percentage for you, but if I remember right, North Platte was sitting somewhere at about 18%, 15 to 18% in there. Way more. I mean, even if it wasn't a tree threatened with an infestating pest, still way too many of that species of tree to have without a threat. So when it is a species that's threatened with a pest, it's even more of an important issue to work on lowering. Well, I guess EAB is going to lower that mix of ash in the community anyways. So developing a preparedness plan in advance, remove your fair and poor quality trees before you have a confirmation, as you're able to justify that to your public. Determine what trees are to be treated. Again, I'll get back to Kansas City a little bit, and they're just, you know, every large metro area has had a different approach to some degree. How extensively they rely on treatments, how extensively they just aggressively remove varies from city to city. In Kansas City, they were approached by a contractor that wanted to do their treatments for them, and gave them a price they couldn't really say no to. And so at $80 a tree, they have a treatment that's effective for two seasons. So they're paying $40 a year per tree to treat selected ash. They're not treating every single one. The notion behind Kansas City's treatment plan is to mitigate that mortality, spread the mortality curve out over a longer period of time, and stage those removals so that they can be done in a more orderly fashion. So they're not trying to keep these trees alive in perpetuity. They're just trying to handle the public relations side of it as well as the operations side, and not have complete chaos and zero control over where trees are dying and when. So with injections, you can keep those trees alive long enough to sort of minimize how much your budget is taxed on any given year. Because while we're talking about a 15-year mortality curve from year zero with the first beetle in the first tree and year 15 with the vast majority of the trees gone, there's still sort of a bell curve that amounts to almost half that mortality happening in a 3 to 5 year window. So you can talk 15 years, but most of that 15 years, there's not nearly as much going on as there is right in the middle of it. When the population is built and there's still a lot of trees that haven't died yet, you're going to have a lot of mortality from that. So 15 years is almost misleading as well when you think of most of those trees dying in a much shorter period of time even than that. So questions on those kind of treatments? I don't know. I always get lots of treatment questions, and I can't answer them all, but we have some experts here that can cover that as well.
That $40 you mentioned, is that that's probably a bid item, so it's not typical. So what on a mature ash tree, what would be the cost?
Your average tree service is going to base that, is going to price that service by the number of injection sites that need to be done. So, and we'll get into treatments more here in a minute, but the short answer is, you know, a couple hundred bucks for a decent sized tree, and you're going to be locked into that cost for the life of the tree. So you have to be asking yourself, do I want this tree on life support forever? Because that's really what's going to happen. And as we'll see later, there's some downsides to the injections as well, and some considerations and some potential, you know, that has some potential to have some implications on the lifespan of the tree as well.
A question?
Yes.
So after the EAB moves through a community in this 15-year survival curve, is it gone then?
No, because you're going to have those outliers that remain and become continual forage or, you know, location for population. You may have a much lower population that sticks around after the fact. I think that's pretty established. But you're also going to, you know, ash trees like to sprout from the base when they die too. So you're going to have trees that, stumps that persist, even though the tree itself is effectively, you know, the whole canopy is lost.
So they won't starve to death.
No, they're not going to run out of stuff to eat. I don't think so. I see, yeah. No, it's a relationship between the population of the beetle and the number of trees that are still left to infest. So if you've seen bell curves before, they occur in nature all over the place. Maybe you have the classic example is rabbits and wolves, right? You don't have a lot of rabbits in a forest. There's not a lot of food for the wolves, and so there's a low population of wolves. Low population of wolves means there's less pressure on the rabbits, and they start to reproduce as they do. And then all of a sudden there's a whole lot of food for wolves, and it's this back and forth, right? So with the bell curve for EAB, what that wolf and rabbit relationship that I'm getting at is between the number of trees that are around and the number of beetles. So in the early stages, there's not a lot of beetles and there's a lot of trees, right? And it takes 4 or 5 years roughly for an infested tree to really succumb and die in the first place. And so that's where we get behind the eight ball, and we got this dead tree. Oh my God, we got ash or emerald ash borer here now. Well, that beetle's had 4 or 5 years or however long to build a population that's already, you know, the cat's out of the bag there.
Right.
So as that population spreads out and infests trees, then you get this crescendo of mortality as the population spreads and the infestation spreads. And then the number of ash trees that's left to infest starts to diminish. And so you come over on the other side of the bell curve, and there's fewer trees left to die, and so then the numbers are going to gradually taper off as there's fewer trees left to infest.
So I guess what I'm asking is, I understand that part of it.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I was wondering about when an emerald ash borer reproduces.
Uh-huh.
How many eggs or whatever does it produce? Because it seems like that's a really fast explosion from just a few to a lot.
Well, and keep in mind, we've got this perfect scenario of non-native pest and native trees with no defenses against the pest, or very few. And so it's not like, another agrillis beetle, bronze birch borer. You know, it takes out paper birch, white birch, European birch, that kind of thing a lot. Closely related beetle, they only go after birch for the most part. Same D-shaped holes, just not in ash, okay? So that's a native pest in a non-native tree, and so it's similar problem. But when you have native trees, native pests, they've sort of sorted things out, and they've made good neighbors with each other. And it's mostly I'm trying to think of a good example. Ash lilac borer. That beetle really needs a tree to, or that wasp in that case, I guess, needs a tree that's already stressed in order to take hold and infest the tree. But all bets are off when you have non-native pest and native tree, or vice versa. And so the reason that that population explodes is just because insects are effective at reproducing rapidly, and the trees are just not ready for that sort of infestation to happen. Anything to add on that, Julie?
The females are a fairly average producer in terms of eggs, 50 to 100 eggs for a female in a lifetime. That's still a lot of eggs.
Yeah.
With that curve, there's the period, I think if I understand that curve right, there's that period before we find the beetle.
Right.
And then that 5 years is really more like a 10-year curve, because it's about 5 years from when we start seeing mortality.
Right. That's what I wasn't getting to.
Those really high numbers of mortality. So
yeah. You don't even have mortality the first couple years.
Where the population's building. When the population gets large enough, we start seeing mortality, and then we see really high mortality in the next 5 years.
Yeah, and then it's right on top of you, and you're going, what happened? Again, back to that scenario of your first find is in year 3, 4, or 5, somewhere in there on a dead tree. Then you've got a population that is already establishing itself and spreading around. So, good question. Thank you for that one. You got any more? Not right now? I love having conversations, like I said earlier. So, keep the questions coming. So, for treatments, you want to identify your high-value trees. You don't want to just treat everything, because, again, this beetle... it doesn't discriminate between poor or good quality or conditioned trees. And so we definitely want to be real selective on which trees we even consider candidates for treatments. Some considerations to keep in mind. Obviously, sentimental value is one. You know, maybe it's an ash tree that you memorialize somebody with, or you planted with your child, or dedicated to somebody. Or you planted it at a particular time in your life that was challenging. You know, there's a lot of reasons people plant trees that have emotional, background to it. Consider environmental benefits. Is the tree perfectly sited to save you energy on your home? It's shading your house. It's some sort of a, you know, could be worked into a windbreak component as a deciduous tree a little bit, or. You know, things along those lines. So not just the condition of the tree itself, but that's definitely, you know, let's eliminate anything that's already in questionable condition from consideration for treatment right off the bat. And on a homeowner case, that's even more so. So, ash is a valuable component. It's difficult to find this pest earlier, as we talked about a little bit. And so you have to accept the fact that you might already be behind the curve on whether the tree's infested or not when you get around to considering your treatments. So you're never going to be able to quit doing these treatments unless, like I said, you're on the municipal level and you're using it as a management strategy, but you're still planning on letting those trees go at some point. You just want some control over how that mortality occurs. The injections do cause some physical damage to the trees. Do trees heal? Do trees heal themselves? No. You know, if I cut myself, I get a scab. Eventually it falls off if I don't pick at it all the time. And then eventually my arm looks like just like it did before. But trees only seal damage off. You know, the analogy of the submarine, I think, is pretty valid, although a submarine can eventually get back to shore and get repaired. But, you know, you're out at sea, you get a hole in a compartment in the submarine. You close off, you seal the hatches, and you make do with that full of water, right? And that's basically what a tree is doing. It compartmentalizes the structure of the wood in such a way that it can divide the wood into damaged and undamaged sections and sort of minimize how far that damage spreads outside of that individual compartment. And so when you're drilling holes into a tree to inject it, or there's a couple methods of getting that in. They don't all involve a drill bit, but they all involve inserting a foreign object into the trunk of the tree and squirting the product into the vascular tissue. Once you get that insecticide into the vascular tissue, then the tree distributes it throughout the leaves and branches, and then as anything is feeding on the tree, it's eating that insecticide as well. But there is damage associated with those injections, and we'll see a couple slides on that in a little bit. The environmental impacts. For young trees, the only real homeowner formulation that's available for EAB that I'm aware of is a soil drench, maybe a trunk drench as well. Do they sell that to the public? Okay. Either way, it amounts to something that's not an injection. It's not damaging to the tree. It's really only good for your smaller trees. It's not a controlled dose. The downside from an environmental standpoint is that those active ingredients have an EPA-regulated amount that can be applied per acre. And when 1 acre of land here in downtown Lincoln could have dozens of homeowners with their own individual properties, not discussing any of this with each other, you get above that threshold real quick and it can have some serious implications to our water table and leaching effects from those products getting applied. Because you go to the garden center, meaning well, you have a young tree, you want to do the soil drench, you buy the bottle, you read the label, it says you apply this much, and you got a whole other bottle. you got a lot left, and so if some's good, more's better, and glug, 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 away you go. Everybody's not going to do that, of course. A lot of people follow the recommended label instructions, but some people won't. And so we're going to have those sort of watershed issues with some of those homeowner treatments. Human exposure is an issue. I hail from the plant healthcare technology realm of things, from tree services, and my exposure to the active ingredients that I used on a day-to-day basis was a cause of concern for me and something that I took very seriously. Not every plant health care tech does. I can tell you that from experience. And so there will be some human exposure to these products as they're not handled properly. And then the cost of the treatments. We got a question about that earlier. And the financial cost is definitely worth considering in terms of whether or not you want to do that. One that I'll add, I guess it's not a drawback per se, but a consideration, is how many years of growth do you have in that tree already? Are you better off cutting bait and planting something else rather than committing to treating this tree that maybe hasn't even really been in your yard all that long in the first place? So there's kind of a photo of how a lot of these injection sites are prepared. You have a drill bit of a specific size. It either accommodates a feeder tube or a hose of some sort with a pressurized delivery system for the active ingredient and the carrier inside. Once you get it into the general area of this site, you're allowing the tree's vascular system to do the rest of the work from there. So the physical damage we mentioned already, but these active ingredients are not water soluble, and so they're all mostly petroleum based, and there's some damage to tree tissue caused by the carrier for these active ingredients in the injections as well, and so that's worth considering. So here's a tree cookie cutout showing not only where those injection sites are, but these at least three of the four walls of coatit that we talk about in terms of trees compartmentalizing decay and stopping it from spreading. So you can see at this stage the trees had, these are usually spaced on 6 inch. I don't know if that's the case for every injection system, but it's kind of the rule of thumb for a lot of them. So year one, you're doing this on 6 inch spacing, and you go around, you get your injection in. We can see how the tree has responded and put pretty decent reaction wood on the outside of that afterwards. But then as you go on, you can't use these same injection sites every year. And so you get this cascading effect of physical damage as you continue to inject the tree year after year into new living tissue. Now, obviously, the tree is going to get bigger with time and open up new injection sites for you to some degree. But you can already start to see that, you can differentiate the newer injection sites from the older by the decay that's already all the way out to the bark versus the older ones that have had some wound wood seal over the top of them. So if obviously, with a live tree, you don't have the benefit of looking at this for that particular tree, and so it's problematic. It's only good information after the fact when the tree's already had that basal prune, as I like to call it. And then here's showing that first wall of coatit in a vertical, which is the way that decay spreads fastest in every species of tree. It's that vertical movement through the vascular tissue of the tree is the easiest way for decay to spread, regardless of the species, regardless of how good it is at slowing decay down. That vertical spread will always be the most significant way that decay moves through a tree. So worth, you know, all this amounts to a cautionary tale. You know, I use the analogy of chemotherapy. You don't just willy-nilly go get chemotherapy because you think you might have a, right? You get chemotherapy because you have something threatening your life and it's the lesser of two evils and you're really trying to get, you know, some sort of cancer knocked back and controlled. So chemotherapy ain't awesome for you, but it can be the better option. And so the damage associated with these, it may be dramatic to compare injection sites with chemotherapy from that standpoint, but it still amounts to some damage to the tree that needs to be taken into consideration. Again, sorry about the readability here. Be selective when deciding which trees to treat. Is the tree in good health? Do we have a confirmation within 15 miles or kind of an adjacent county is how that shakes out in most cases. Is the tree high value for a number of considerations? Is it sited in a good location? Is it being cared for well? If you're going to just treat the tree but not, you know, try to maintain the vigor of the tree in any other way in terms of watering it through dry spells, mulching it, keeping, mowing equipment away from that chronic damage to the trunk, those sort of things, then don't bother with the injections, watering, mulching, all that sort of thing. So only those trees that are already in good health should even be considered. A tree that's in poor health is not going to take an injection out very well anyways. So if you have thinning or dieback in the tree, we're already getting into a scenario where you probably want to shy away from treatments with knowing that their level of efficacy is going to be diminished. Was the tree pruned poorly? All this lion tailing, canopy clearing. You know, this is classic treatment for ash trees for people that don't know how to prune properly. You cut everything off the branch, leave a little tuft at the end. That's problematic for a number of reasons, but you're significantly reducing the vigor of the tree.
Sorry, I'm not a tree person, but what is lion tailing?
So you picture a lion tail. It's pretty. It's got short hair and then a tuft of fur at the end of it. So what's happened with this tree is a tree service came through and they cut off every darn branch off, a little sprout off the sides, and they just leave branches at the end. Now ash is arranged opposite. So if my body is a branch, my lateral branches are going to be a mirror image on both sides rather than alternating. Okay, and so it doesn't seem like it would, but that really plays into people's mindsets when they get in the tree and start pruning it. And they get really aggressive with taking all these out and not leaving any permanent branch structure to establish lower down below. And for whatever reason, ash is just one of those trees that gets done to a lot. Under the guise of canopy cleaning is usually how it's referred to in the bid. You bet. A lot of epicormic sprouts could be indicative of bore damage in the tree or some other decline. Decay conchs on the branches, again, a sign of decay in the tree and a tree that's not in good condition. More poor pruning cuts with decay present or sprouts from around the edge of that. Existing bore damage, native bores in lots of cases. Again, another candidate, another tree that's not a good candidate for treatment. Just more of these kind of photos here. The mower blight, is the tree just getting banged with the mower chronically week after week? That's having significant impacts on the tree and not one you'd want to treat. Included bark, codominant leaders, all these kind of things, pruning concepts we talk about, don't bother trying to keep those around. Are they not sited well? Are they heaving the concrete? Do they not have enough soil volume to become a big mature tree anyways? So once we have a confirmation, then there will be probably drop-off sites established for tree services to bring their infested wood. If you're operating inside the quarantine county, you can really kind of move that wood around as you please, right? Within the quarantine area. If your dump site is outside the county that you're working in, though, it may be important for that county to establish some location for you to bring that wood and keep it inside the quarantine. Anything to add there, Julie?
With all the municipalities there, I think that's something that's really important for cities and counties to be doing now is identifying places that they're going to allow people to bring wood. You know, it's one thing for you to figure out how you're going to manage your own wood waste from a street tree point of view, but realizing that there's a lot of trees that are going to be private trees, and it's probably best for a municipality to consider how they want to assist with the disposal of that green waste material. If it's not fairly easy and not fairly inexpensive, it will end up being a problem for the municipality, as in people will not take down trees on private property if they don't have a way to dispose of it, or they will dispose of it, maybe be more inclined to dispose of it in ways that the public entities would not like the nighttime drop-offs at your trash dumps or dropping it off in ditches and then the city has to deal with the cleanup anyway.
Yeah.
So identifying yards and identifying ways for the public to be able to dispose of their own green waste will be really important.
And this may not be the best example, but think of like Christmas tree drop-offs. Mm-hmm. You know, the city can deal with having all those on the curb, or they can set up a convenient location for people to freely come dump their Christmas tree and be done with it. And then you have a bottleneck also for a lot of that material to be utilized better instead of just going in the landfill. So that can serve a couple purposes. So in terms of controlling the beetle, it's really ideal to maybe take out any dead or infested trees before mid-May when those adults are gonna emerge and fly on to other locations. But again, Pandora's box is kind of open already by the time you have it in the community. But you can still do a service to the community trying to minimize the spread of that beetle in trees when you take them down. So on the quarantine, all life stages of the beetle are regulated, nursery stock, limbs, branches, logs, you know, any piece of the tree is going to have some regulations that go along with it. You want to talk about the compliance agreement real quick?
Sure. So go out of a quarantined area and into a non-quarantined area, you're going to have a compliance agreement, either with the state or the USDA. It's a legal document that you know, the federal or the state side regulatory folks will say, here's what we understand and what we're going to require, and the entity, the city, the private firm, the homeowner, whoever, will, you know, there'll be a clearly delineated list spelled out of what their requirements are, what they're agreeing to do, and then everybody signs off. And it allows, there is some oversight still by the regulatory agencies, but it allows then, let's say a large tree service to, depending on the situation, either receive or move regulated articles. So like if you're a big firewood producer and you're living in an area that is under quarantine, but you sell to folks that are outside the quarantine area, you'll enter into a compliance agreement where you agree to either debark or heat treat or fumigate the firewood before it leaves the quarantine so that it can leave the quarantine.
Right. And here's some of those that Julie's talking about. So you can heat treat the wood, debark it, heat treatments or fumigation methods. And I think some of those are more preferred than others in terms of...
They're all very specific. The most common one for firewood that I see is the heat treatment. I'm not a big fan of the debarking because it's 100% bark-free plus a half inch of wood. It's hard from the regulatory side to look at a piece of wood and know how much was removed from it. And also it's very, very hard to get to that 100% debarking level. So most firewood producers in the infested areas that I deal with when we are monitoring product coming,
which is kind of ironic, they're heating up firewood so they can move it and have it burned. But so there's that maximum 1 inch and two dimensions we talked about earlier, the nursery stock. There's a phone number for Department of Ag. They're really a great resource, and obviously the people to call if you have a suspicious tree. Julie and I work to field those calls and respond to them and check on them as they come in. And then just kind of this chain of custody. I really just want to probably get to a break so we can keep things rolling. Any last EAB questions here before we take a quick 10-minute break? Yes?
Maybe this is a given, but why the 1 inch by, why the 1 by 1? What does that actually accomplish?
It's chipping up most of the larvae that might be in the tree still alive. Julie, any?
Yeah. That's.
Aren't they smaller than that?
If they were, they could be. I mean, it's not a guarantee, but it's a best practice.
I don't know. And they need a kind of a protected environment to stay alive in.
Not,
Nicole was mentioning it.
The larvae's not tough.
Right.
If you expose it, it will desiccate. So the chipping process itself is pretty physical.
Just being exposed.
They're going to get exposed.
Yeah.
So research has shown, USDA again has done a lot of research on this, and research has shown that should be helpful.
Right. So. Yeah, and there was some speculation about whether Minnesota winters were going to knock them back, low temperatures haven't been shown to control the beetle to any real degree. So let's take a quick break, and we'll come back and finish up the morning session.